Thank you. handsome to me. That's what I always call my brother. I always call him handsome whenever we greeted one another. You stood tall and happy to serve. You did not understand the word never. My brother, you always had a fighting soul. You prepared us for this time, and I thank you. The emptiness death leaves will always be there. Only a few months ago, you were the one reassuring me that all will be well when my son passed. And I want to reassure his children, his wife, his siblings and friends that he is in a better place. Brother, you were the only millionaire I know. You were rich in compassion, rich in strength, rich in intelligence, rich in sacrifice, rich in love, rich in advice, rich in encouragement, rich in integrity. Brother, rest in the arms of the Master. I love you and I miss you. So soar with the angels. Continue to sleep or to rest in peace. And I know your memory and love in our hearts will never, ever cease. I thank you.
How can I say thanks for all the things you've done for me? Things so undeserved, yet you give and prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude. All that I am and ever hope to be, I owe it all to you. The chorus says, to God be the glory. To God be the glory for the things he has done. First, I would like to thank Mr. Cain's family for giving me the opportunity to share a few memories of him and our affiliation. I choose to believe in January of 2000, God would have orchestrated a divine appointment for me to be able to meet Mr. Cain. I went seeking betterment for my life, and the Lord provided that through Mr. Cain, where he became my mentor in the business. He really took the time to make sure that I understood the business and what was required to be successful. I'm not sure that I took all the tips and used them effectively, but he made sure that he imparted his knowledge to me. Indeed, I can remember him taking us out in that green Baleno, and I think that was the company car at the point in time. Because everyone had the opportunity at some point in time, I believe, to use that green Baleno to go on an appointment. Mr. Cain was my friend, a confidant. I could speak to him about any matter and tell him all my inner thoughts and never once felt judged by him. He would listen and give me wise counsel about all matters. Mr. Cain was my father. He made sure I was protected, that I was taken care of, that I lacked nothing. And by extension, he passed that love on to my family, both my nuclear family and my extended family. He loved them, and we loved him. He would make sure that he inquired about us, about our health, and in any way that he could lend assistance in telling us about something, he would make sure. He shared in our joys, and he shared in our pains. So today, as I say goodbye to my father, to my friend, and to my mentor, it's not really with a heavy heart. It is with love. For I know he took the time to take care of his physical temple. Every doctor appointment, every dental appointment, every meal, everything. Mr. Cain was so meticulous in trying to make sure that he lived as long as he could. He would always say, "Joanne, I'm not afraid of dying, but I want to make sure that I live long enough to see my children grow up." I watched over the years as your body failed you, and I remember your prayer always to see your children grow up. And God has indeed answered your request. As you take your place in that heavenly realm, among that great crowd of witnesses, to share the remainder of us that are still here on. Mr. Cain, I want to thank you so much for being so selfless and pouring into my life over the 22 years I have known you. And when that great day comes, I will be looking for you. There's another song that I would like to leave you with. It says, "If I can help somebody as I travel along, if I can help somebody with a word or a song, if I can help somebody from doing wrong, then my living will not be in vain." Your living was not in vain. I want to thank you so much. And thank you, everyone.
Good evening to one and all. My tribute in song to Clyde. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, lift up your gaze and sing, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna to your King. Last night I lay asleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in New Jerusalem beside the temple there. I hear the children singing, and ever as they sang, methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Methought the voice of angels from him in answer rang. Jerusalem, 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 lift up your gaze and sing, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to the King. Then I thought my dream was changed. The streets no longer rise. Hush were the glad hosannas the little children sang. The skies grew dark with mystery. The morn was cold and chilled as a shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. As the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, lift up your gates and sing, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to the King. And once again, the scene was changed. New earth there seemed to be. I saw the holy city beside the tideless sea. The lights of God was on its way. The gates were open wide, and all who would might enter, and no one was denied. No need of moon or stars by night or sun to shine by day. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, sing for the night is o'er. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna forevermore. Oh,
Yeah, that's there. Good evening. Clyde Cain joined 57 more of us, 58. We were 59 Barbadians on the 16th day of October 1971, Course 53, Royal Barbados Police Force. Fortunate for us, a number of us are still, those who are still alive, we are here to pay reverence and honor to our colleague. There aren't many persons whom people can say didn't have enemies. And I'll tell you, Clyde Cain was one of them. From the time we went to the Regional Police Training Center until now, his mortal remains are there. This picture, this one is old, but this is Clyde Cain. Always with a smile. I cannot remember ever seeing CC not smiling. Always had something funny to say. Persons say that I hardly read, talk a lot of foolishness. But Clyde was something else. We came to the training center for 6 months, and then we went to our various stations, divisions. He went to the Southern Division, up to District C. I went to the Northern Division, to Holtown. All of us went all over the place, Central Station, traffic, mobile. But Clyde Cain would always be there with us. Colleague, if only we can get the force to operate this way now. Clyde Cain, wherever Clyde was, he would always find time to say something that would make you smile. He also had his serious side, because history of this country would record there was a murder years ago in St. John. And believe it or not, he was the police officer when we were searching the area for the body. Clyde found the body. He's a good detective, too. The word good is used nowadays. Sometimes we wonder if it really should be used to describe certain persons and things. But where's CC? And please forgive me if I keep calling him CC, because as we were friends, and that CC came with a joke too, but always meant a CC. But after that, he discovered that he had his grounding in the Royal Barbados Police Force, as it was then. Now it's called the Barbados Police Service. But he decided to move on, and he went into the life underwriting. And with the same smile, with the same way he greeted persons when he was a policeman, he went on into his new profession. But he did not forget the police force. All the police officers that we felt wanted insurance, you can rest assured, CC was there. Some of them are here too. Yes, we are here today also. And Clyde, we would always be at our colleagues' funerals. You can rest assured. Even when Clyde was physically challenged, he still ensured that he got to his colleague's funeral. It was as if he never, ever gave up being a police officer. In fact, there's a saying, once a police, always a police. And where CC is concerned, that one was true. So, if you would have heard us having a joke in the back and speaking, well, I cannot do anything but speak loudly. It is not that we disrespect our colleague. It is that we loved him. We enjoyed being with him. We enjoyed each and every moment we were together. And at this day, where we see him now, resting there for the last time we'll be seeing him, we are saying to him, well done, you good and faithful servant. You have served the country and the people well. Rest in peace. Thank you.
Good evening. There are many ways in which I can pay tribute to my late brother, but I want to share a story with you and then some words of sentiments. I am the little brother to Clyde Cain. My earliest memories of my brother goes back to the year 1973. I had just turned 3 years old and was at home under the care of our mother. I must have been asleep because I remember waking up to a conversation between my mother and Clyde. She was saying to him, "You will have to ask him yourself. You see, one of my older siblings had entered our names in a competition, which at the time was sponsored by one of the popular soft drink manufacturers. Fortunate for me, my name was drawn. And as a result, I had won a large bath towel and a torchlight. My brother wanted the torchlight. So basically the conversation was to try to convince me to give up the torchlight. He came over to me as I was lying down and he said, "I need this torchlight." And I reached out to take the torchlight from him. But instead of giving me the torchlight, he placed an O. Henry chocolate bar in my hand. He explained to me, "I am a police officer, and I need this torchlight that will help me see when outside get dark. And besides, all policemen must have a torchlight as part of their accoutrements." Like I would have known what that word meant at the time. I must have agreed because by the time I was cleaned up from the melted chocolate in my hand and he had already eaten his lunch, he was on his way out through the door. I remember asking my mother if he was going to bring back the torchlight for me, but she did not respond. So I remember telling her to tell him to bring it back so that when I became a policeman, I can use it too. I remember my brother looked back and he burst out in laughter. And he said to me, "Boy, you are so smart that you would really make a good policeman in truth." He left and I never saw that torchlight again. So to any of his ex-colleagues who are here today, who would have worked with him during the period 1973, and you can remember seeing that red and white torchlight, that is the one he got from me. Our brother Clyde was a loving individual with a sense of humor that was unmatched. He appreciated life and tried to live it to the fullest. He was very intelligent and a hard worker who put his all into everything that he did. To us, his siblings, he was more than a big brother. We saw him as a protector, an encourager, the peacekeeper, an advisor, and the one who would counsel us when we had our personal problems or other issues. We would have witnessed the frailties of the human body and the frailties of life in the latter stages of our brother's existence. but we also witnessed the strength of his will and spirit. He inspired us to be strong, motivated, and to be determined despite our situation and challenges. A double amputee who lost both of his legs, but was still able to stand tall and to walk far. I know that there may have been many reasons why my brother persevered and remained unfazed by his challenges and physical condition. And I am certain that he did not endure nor persevere for himself, but to show us all that despite your beginnings, despite your situation, in spite of your challenges, it would be a result of your character, self-discipline, self-belief, and actions that will set the example for your families, friends, loved ones, colleagues, and everyone you come into contact with or who knows your story. Our brother touched many lives, helped many people, and inspired many, many more. He has built and left a good legacy, one that we can learn from, aspire to keep, and continue in. You've done well, big brother. You've run a good race and fought a good fight. I pray that your eternal rest will be peaceful and that we will meet someday again. Goodbye, dear brother, and we love you.
Good afternoon. Kindly stand with me as we sing the hymn, Through All the Changing Scenes of Life.
All that are distressed. Let us pray. Our eternally Heavenly Father, you are the author and giver of life. God, we thank you for the life of our beloved brother Clyde. God, I pray, God, even now that you will comfort everyone, God, who is mourning. Death is not easy, but God, at this time, may they feel your everlasting arms. Come and comfort them, giving your peace that passeth all understanding. And God, take them through this period, and may they draw closer together as family, but even closer together with you. In Jesus' name, amen.
We'll continue with our worship as we sing the next two songs that are in your hymn sheet.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great. Your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship Your holy name. And on that day, when my strength is failing, the end draws near, and my time has come. Still my soul sings your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship His holy name. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus.
What a wonderful name it is,
the name of Jesus. Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you, you silenced the bones of sin and grave.
Testify, Lord, that there is no name like the name of Jesus. We honor you this evening, Lord. Kindly take your seats. We'll now have the scripture readings. The first scripture reading, Psalm 23. This will be read by Lawrence Cullimore. Then we'll have following the second scripture reading by Gloria King Curtin. We'll then have the eulogy followed by a solo.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The word of the Lord.
The second reading is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, reading from verses 51 through 55. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality,
then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Here ends the reading.
Thank you all. Can you hear me? Thank you all for gathering here today to mourn my father's passing, but more so to celebrate his life and considerable legacy. It is not a simple thing to sum up the development and impact of one man's life, the vastness of his experiences, the depths of his relationships, and the power of the memories he created whilst here on earth. All of you will have your own stories to share, your personal recollections of time spent together, and the ones you will cherish most of all. As a family, we are deeply grateful for the love and appreciation you showed to our father, and want you to know that it meant the world to him. Clyde Lee Austin Cain was born on March 15, 1951, in Martins Bay, St. John, the son of Cynthia Collamore and Prince Albert Bradshaw. Eternally proud of his roots as a country boy, he was known to speak fondly of his days running miles to school, barefoot through the rain or the hot sun. One of his earliest memories was surviving Hurricane Jeanette, fleeing in the midst of the storm with his mother and baby brother to escape the dangerous conditions. As a child, he was teased for his humble upbringing, with the neighborhood boys chanting, "One pants, you got one pants, and you're wearing it home, and you're wearing it tongue." These were all formative childhood memories, which Dad told with a smile, where he never quite focused on the hardship of growing up during that time, but rather on the necessity of persevering through whatever adversity life might present in the pursuit of a greater goal. This theme of perseverance would be a defining feature of my father's life and truly represents what we consider to be his best quality, the ability to overcome immense personal challenges while remaining not only optimistic, but profoundly altruistic towards those around him. Dad was known for writing his own speeches, so I am keenly aware of how he would be judging this one we narrate today. At many of his speaking arrangements, he would quote his favorite lines from the legendary Frank Sinatra's song, My Way, which summed up his life's philosophy. Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. Most of my father's notable abilities were cultivated early in life. Through his mother's firm guidance, her children learned to cook early and well. The result of this was that as an adult, my father was no slouch in the kitchen. He would often brag of having taught his wife to cook, a claim she insists is up for debate. Cooking was a way for my father to express his love of people and his zest for life. He was a man who richly enjoyed the kind of camaraderie that could be uniquely fostered through the sharing of a tasty plate of food. He loved to cook different meals, with two special favorites being pudding and sauce and cow heel soup. He knew just how to keep a turkey moist when in the oven and never grew tired of repeated calls requesting just how to prepare the best ham for Christmas. That was the thing about my father. You could call that man for anything, and in the rare instance he didn't know the answer, he would seek to find out. Whether it was a recipe, a question about a current news event, or needing to find the location of an obscure venue throughout Barbados, he knew just where to direct you to. Dad might have been born in St. John, but he became a true son of the nation, with a preternatural ability to locate any place on the island without needing a map, a skill we attributed to his years spent as a policeman. He had a knack for making people feel special, whether he had just met you or had known you all your life. He was known for giving sound advice and could be relied upon in any emergency to lend a helping hand or a compassionate word. I remember him volunteering with an organization that helped persons living with multiple sclerosis. On some evenings, I would journey with him as he drove patients to their appointments, shouldering the burden of physically assisting them in their wheelchairs and with other tasks. My father wasn't the type to pay lip service to service. He believed in the dignity of others and viewed it as a personal responsibility to help those who struggle to help themselves. This generosity and kindness of spirit would be returned to him later in life when he too needed it. My father's children were his pride and joy. He loved us and celebrated our different strengths and attributes, even though we didn't always make it easy for him while growing up. Dad was fiercely protective, and we were girls. Dad would always engage our prospective suitors with a warm smile, but a cautionary word. A young admirer's no problem was met by Dad's bemused reply, "What problem could it be?" He never missed a birthday and was often the first to call. He loved to remind us that we were 1 year older and hence catching him. When my brother Roger turned 50, and Dad had to film a birthday message to send to him, he did endless takes, making sure everything was just right to give Roger as close to perfect a video as he could imagine. A favorite story of Dad's to tell with amusement was of him sweating, hurrying across the Chamberlain Bridge in Bridgetown to buy my sister a tennis racket because Lisa had indicated a passing interest in playing the sport while at Harrison's College. Of course, after securing the prized object, my father quickly learned that Lisa's seemingly keen interest was short-lived, and he was not going to be raising the next Venus or Serena Williams. Despite the racket's rather sad demise, I like to think of it as a symbol, not only of my father's committed investment in his children, but of his enduring belief in our potential, no matter the odds. Dad was our champion, cheering us up when sad, sick, or otherwise downcast. He stressed the importance of education. I would often boast of having 3 first-class honors graduates from the University of the West Indies, Lisa and Natasha in accounting, and me in English. Our academic achievements gave him a pride beyond measure, for which he took personal credit, and used to say that we all have the Cain brain. His belief was further cemented when Natasha's daughter, Sahara, recently passed for Queen's College and was in the top 10 in maths in the island. He said, "You see what I told you? The Cain brain again." Sahara herself is now convinced and tells her father, Harcourt, "Sorry, Daddy, but I thank God I have the Cain brain." As much as Dad could be lighthearted and supportive in the endeavors of his children, he was equally so when it came to our childhood friends and the children of his relatives and colleagues. He took on a meaningful father figure role that I know many in the audience have fond memories of and will always cherish. One of the highlights of my father's recreation time was watching or listening to cricket on whatever medium was available. He was a true aficionado of the sport and discussed copious details on every aspect of the game, past and present. Dad also loved the simplicity of a long country drive, listening to music, and taking in the beauty of the scenic landscape. He was an avid exercise enthusiast, having started way back in his youth and as a newly married man, going on long jogs in the early morning with his wife. He stressed the value of exercise and kept it up, this time on the treadmill, right up to the last years of his life. Another distinguishing feature of our father was his deep-rooted love of learning and his eagerness to share that knowledge with others. Some of my earliest memories are of sitting on Dad's lap as he read to us from storybooks or regaled us with tales from his past. Dad could usually opine on most topics of the day and had a passion for history and politics in particular. His morning couldn't get off to a good start unless he had read the daily newspaper, and his night wasn't complete until he had watched the evening news. You could have raised the topic of any local or international issue taking place, and he would be able to give you an informed opinion on it. I suppose that's why many family members regarded him as a font of wisdom and continually sought his advice. His role as a big brother ensured a close bond with his younger siblings, in particular his sister Nita. Over the years, they were able to rely on each other as they raised families and enjoyed a naturally warm and cheerful relationship right till the end. Dad spent a number of years in the police force, which you would have heard about today in some of the tributes, and made many lifelong friends there, before taking up another career as an insurance agent at the Pan American International Insurance Corporation. As both a policeman and an insurance agent, his intelligence and charisma shone through, and colleagues naturally gravitated to his orbit. At Pan American, he became a star employee, regularly receiving accolades and awards both locally and regionally throughout the industry, leading to his appointment as agency manager in 2008. His work in insurance truly captured his passion for helping others in practical ways. It was the ideal fit for a man who loved to engage with people from all walks of life while getting them to appreciate the value of having something set aside as an investment for future financial security. Throughout his time there, Dad exemplified the values of hard work, commitment, and above it all, perseverance, as he pursued professional excellence while contending with health challenges that impacted his physical mobility. For many people, the loss of a limb triggers depression, feelings of hopelessness, and can make the individual retreat from society, unable to find a way back to making a meaningful impact in their communities. However, instead of retreating, Dad emerged anew, continuing to work and travel and host gatherings, and met with others who had lost limbs to offer encouragement. Upon losing his first leg, the right one, Dad simply switched to master driving with his left foot. He learned to walk with two prostheses and never complained about the rough hand life had dealt him. He persevered through these challenges and in so doing provided a remarkable lesson for us all in how to approach life, not with an eye to minimize suffering, but to embrace progress and setbacks with equal gusto. It was this positive attitude that earned him the admiration from so many of his contemporaries, and we often heard of how he was an inspiration for others contesting with their own struggles. Dad knew that life was worth living, and sometimes you had to live that life in ways you didn't expect. But it could still be fulfilling, it could still be enriching, it could still be a life well lived. With the support of family and friends, and a strong reliance and faith in God, he was able to persist and prosper. His weekly meetings, where he was able to worship in fellowship and learn about the Word of God, truly sustained him later in life. Dad wouldn't have wanted us to dwell in sadness for him, for his passing. He had regrets, but there were truly too few to mention in a life that encompassed so much and was lived with such dynamism and hope. He's had an indelible influence on us all and will never be forgotten. Rest in peace, Dad. We love you and will miss you dearly. Thank you. I'd like to say a special thank you to Dad's caretakers who performed such a crucial role for him. As he faced health challenges towards the end of his life, Veronica, Janice, and Alex, we love you, and we can never thank you enough. Thank you.
Thank you. Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. Earth and heaven will pass away. God will make all things knew that day. But are we prepared? Or is this a dream? Slowly, the names from the book are read. I know the king. So there's no need to dread. Are we prepared? Or is this a dream? See over there, there's a mansion. Oh, that's prepared just for me. Where I will live with my Savior eternally. Are we prepared? Or is that a dream? And there will be no more night, no more pain, no more tears, never crying again. And praises to the great I am. We will live in the light of the risen Lamb. Church, be prepared, for this is reality. On behalf of our founding pastor, Pastor Rosie Williams, the board of directors, the pastoral team, the members of the People's Cathedral, we extend our deepest condolences to the family, relatives, and friends at the going home of your loved one. I'd like to acknowledge the members of the Barbados Police Service, as well as the management and staff of Pan American International Insurance. Prepare to meet your God. I address you briefly on the theme. Amos chapter 4, verse 12 to 13, and Romans chapter 10, verse 13 tells us, prepare to meet your God in judgment, you people of Israel. For the Lord is the one who shaped the mountains, stirs up the winds, and reveals his thoughts to mankind. He turns the light of dawn into darkness and treads on the heights of the earth. The Lord God of heaven's armies is his name. And there is great hope for those who take heed to this warning. Romans chapter 10, verse 13 tells us, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Let's just bow our hearts this evening. Father, Lord, we thank you for your anointed word, and we pray that your word would have free course in the hearts of your people this evening to strengthen and to encourage us and to draw us all closer to you. Prepare to meet your God. Our text in Amos paints for us a picture of the urgent call of God to a rebellious people to change their minds and ways of living and return to him. The nation of Israel, a people chosen by God to be his very own, had fallen to a state of disobedience and rebellion that angered and broke the heart of God. Biblical history reveals to us the story of their journey, having been chosen by God as his special people to display his power and glory to the rest of the world. After years of oppression in Egypt and their long journey through the wilderness, God eventually brought the children of Israel into the promised land, a land of provision, a land of protection and guidance, which led to times of much growth and prosperity in the land of Canaan. However, as fate would have it, the children of Israel repeatedly became proud, arrogant, and rebellious. They believed that they had accomplished all their wealth on their own strength, and so they turned their backs on God. In response, God, in his sovereignty as a holy and just God, sent his word to the people through his prophet Amos. The word came in the form of a reminder of his faithfulness and a warning of the consequences for their wicked actions. God also pleaded with them to change their thoughts and attitudes towards him so that they should avoid the perils of destruction which would be visited upon them. Chapter 5 of Amos paints for us a picture of the times that the prophet was in. How you hate honest judges. How you despise people who tell the truth. You trample the poor, stealing their grain through taxes and unfair rent. Is there any relevance to the word of God today? Therefore, though you build beautiful stone houses, you will never live in them. Though you plant lush vineyards, you will never drink wine from them. For I know the vast number of your sins and the depth of your rebellions. You oppress good people by taking bribes and deprive the poor of justice in your courts. Is there any relevance of the word of God today? So those who are smart keep their mouth shut, for it is an evil time. God calls on them to do what is good and run from evil so that you may live. Then the Lord God of heaven's armies will be your helper, just as you have claimed. Hate evil and love what is good. Turn your courts into true halls of justice. Perhaps yet the Lord God of heaven's armies will have mercy on the remnant of his people. The response of the people to God's warning was one of rejection of the messenger Amos. Today, preachers are still rejected as messengers of God. But really and truly, they were rejecting God himself. It was God's word that he was sending through his messengers. You see, God must be taken at his word. His thoughts and his ways are truly higher than those of mere mortal men with our finite understanding. So what then is the significance of the need for preparation for a people today? God has spoken through his son of another time of his visitation that will come. This time includes the return of Jesus and times of tribulations that we must be prepared for. Matthew chapter 24 verse 3, it gives the story of the account of the disciples. They were questioning Jesus about when this end time will come. In verse 3 it says, later Jesus sat on the Mount Olives. His disciples came to him privately and said, tell us, when will all this happen? What sign will signal your return and the end of the world? Yes, church. This world as we know it will one day be no more. Although Jesus did not answer the specific question, he did, however, warn of the perilous times that were to come. Great tribulations as never seen since the world began. Verse 35 tells us of the reality that heaven and earth will pass away. And 2 Peter chapter 3 verse 10 tells us, but the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burnt up. Shouldn't we be prepared for such times of tribulation? And yes, God has provided us with hope, for verse 39 tells us of the coming of his son Jesus Christ, the Messiah, who will take those of us who are with him, who belong to him, to be in a special place in eternity. Those who believe in him and his word, we must therefore be prepared to meet him in the air. Oh, how wonderful. Oh, how marvelous. However, many will be deceived and be unprepared. Like the prophet Amos, we, God's messengers, will be rejected. And some will find themselves like the five foolish virgins or like the rich man in Luke chapter 16. Hear his words. The rich man shouted, Father Abraham, have some pity. Send Lazarus over here to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue. I am in anguish in these flames. But Abraham said to him, son, remember that during your lifetime, you had everything you wanted. And Lazarus had nothing. So now he is here being comforted and you are in anguish. And besides, there's a great chasm separating us. No one can cross over to you from here. And no one can cross over to us from there. Then the rich man said, please, Father Abraham, at least send him to my father's home. For I have 5 brothers, and I want him to warn them so they don't end up in this place of torment. We have to be prepared to avoid such perilous times. In the natural, we are prepared for all types of pending natural disasters. There are all types of drills, fire drill, hurricane drills, tsunami drills. We stock up for the hurricane season. And when there's no hurricane, we curse the Met offices. Yet we fail to make the necessary preparation for the true and definite reality of the coming of Jesus Christ. We fail to make preparation for the new heaven and the new earth that is being prepared for those who follow Jesus and are looking forward to be with him and his Father in eternity. Church, we need to be prepared. God opens the door for a remnant, a special people. He also opens the door for restoration. So it doesn't matter where you may be at this point in time. God has made a way. The hope for us today is the reality that death is not a major stop on this journey. It's more like the crossroads. The question is, which direction are you heading in? Are you looking forward to eternal life with your God or eternal torment? Revelation chapter 21 from verse 1 tells us, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the old heaven and old earth had disappeared, and the sea was also gone. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven like a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. I heard a low shout from the throne saying, look, God's home is now among the people. He will live with them and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes and there will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain. All these things are gone forever. And the one sitting on the throne said, look, I am making everything new. And then he said to me, write this down, for what I tell you is trustworthy and true. And he also said, it is finished. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To all who are thirsty, I will give freely from the springs of the water of life. And all who are victorious will inherit all these blessings. And I will be their God, and they will be my children. But cowards, unbelievers, the corrupt, murderers, the immortal, moral, those who practice witchcraft, idol worshippers, and all liars, their fate is in the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death. This evening, the choice is yours to make. The preparation begins with accepting Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. All who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And the picture paints a beautiful picture. The scripture paints a beautiful picture of salvation. Romans chapter 4 from verse 7 tells us, oh, what joy for those whose disobedience is forgiven, whose sins are put out of sight. Yes, what joy for those whose record the Lord has cleared of sin. And today this could be your reality. I offer you Jesus. Will you accept this invitation? Will you do like our brother Clyde and be prepared to meet God? The one opportunity I had to meet Clyde at the hospital, I admired the depths of his faith. His life said to me then that it was a life of preparation for all here on earth, but a life of preparation to see his God when his time came. His time came. Each one of us here today will suffer a similar fate. Are we prepared? Kindly stand. This evening, all those within the hearing of my voice is without excuse. The word of God has been spoken. The decision is yours. While heads are bowed and eyes are closed, this is a personal point of interest between you and your God. If the Spirit of God has ministered this word to you, and you feel that you need to be prepared to meet your God, just say in your heart, Father Lord, I understand that my sins will separate me from you. I believe that you sent Jesus today to pay the price for my sins so that I now can be made right with you. I receive him now as my Lord and my Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Father Lord, we thank you for those souls that have come back to you. We rejoice this evening and we look forward to seeing them in eternity. For the family members and loved ones, Father Lord, we pray that your hand of comfort will be upon them, that you will undergird them with your righteous right hand as they go through this period of grief. I pray that it will draw them closer together as a family. I pray that it will draw them closer to you and that they too will become members of the family of God. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Remain standing as we sing the hymn, How Great Thou Art.
My soul, my Savior, God. Asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. We have gathered here to commit the body of our beloved Clyde Cain. We have shared through these passing years a wonderful companionship and fellowship with our brother. We cherish the many blessed and hallowed memories that come to us in these moments. His faithfulness and friendship will continue their radiance and testimony in our lives. In the name of Jesus Christ, whom he loved and served, we commit his body to rest. Earth to earth, dust to dust, ashes to ashes. Knowing that his spirit is with the Lord in his heavenly house. In so doing, we rest our hearts in fresh confidence upon the sure and certain hope of the resurrection to life through Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body that it may be conformed to his glorious body, according to the working by which he is able even to subdue all things to himself.
Father, once again, thank you for the life of our beloved brother Cain. God, we know to be absent from the body, we see present with you. But once again, God, we pray, God, that your peace, that passes all understanding, your love, your comfort, will rest upon family, friends, all who come to celebrate this life. And even God, as this time will go on, the morning period will still go on, God, may they know that you are walking with them and take them through your spirit. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. the goodness of God. sing in my own.
No, you see different perspective, buddy. Yeah. Different perspectives is always welcome. Always welcome.
Father, we thank you that you are indeed the giver of life. So may the memories of Clay be used, dear God, to encourage and support and give comfort to the family members. We thank you, dear God, that you are the giver of eternal life, and so they can have hope, though they mourn. And with the resurrection of the dead, they too will see him in eternity. So we give you honor, glory, and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good afternoon. We just want to say a final thank you to all of us who joined us for the service and now at the graveside. It was always our intention to give Dad this uplifting and hopeful send-off in order to reflect the kind of man he was and what he would have wanted. As I said earlier, he wouldn't have wanted, you know, us to feel sad or depressed, because we all know my dad, CC, Clyde Cain, whatever you called him, you know that he lived his life in a very, very happy and joyous way. So thank you again for all of you who could make it here to pass on your respects, and we appreciate it more than we could ever say. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.